I'm leaning on God. I'm trusting that the Holy Spirit is going to teach me something about God. And so I listen.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
Well, very blessed. Can't wait to tell you why.
Wait. Happy birthday. I know I'm a day late, but happy birthday anyway.
That's okay. Thank you for the birthday greetings. Sure. And this morning, I got up early. I mean, early, and I'm going to share what I found in God's word, what he showed me, and I was studying. And then I felt like I really needed to go for a walk by myself, no dogs, nobody else, and just go seek God this morning. So I studied scripture for about an hour, and then I headed off and I sought God according to the principles of Psalm 100. You know, I sang, I gave thanks, I made a joyful shout, I praised his name, and partway through, I felt like God said, okay, time to turn back. So I turned around, and I was heading home, and then I stopped for a while on a bridge, and I kept praying, and it was awesome. So I got some good stuff, and then I came walking up towards our front door, which is glass, and I saw John. Now, when you look in our front door, what you see is the dining room table. And John was dusting it with a towel. I came in to find out that he had set three places, moved all the other chairs in the corner. I should show you pictures of this. And he put three places, and he made it very clear that he wanted me to make eggs for breakfast for the three of us. This was like our birthday breakfast. Even though it's a day late, we went out to eat last night. That boy just, I'm almost tearing up just telling you, he had it in his heart that we were going to have a special breakfast together. So I come out into the kitchen. He's already got three bowls of yogurt with blueberries in them. He's cut up strawberries. He gave me a peach. He says, you. So then I have to cut up the peach. He had meat, eggs, peppers, and cheese set out. He told me. Oh, yeah. So I'm the chef. So anyway, I had to cut up the peppers and the sausage and made a little egg omelet, so to speak. And that's when I texted you. I said, I might be a couple minutes late because I was just going to come downstairs. I was actually early. And I thought, no, I'm going to sit here and we're going to do this. And so we sat down and Sandy prayed and we ate this wonderful breakfast. Then I quick brushed his teeth and he's off. And what a boy. And last night we were singing to each other because we don't have to sit there looking funny while people sing to us. We can sing to each other because Sandy and I share the same birthday. Did you know that?
No, I did not know that.
That's yeah, awesome. Yeah. So that's why we go out for our birthday dinner, but this was his way of blessing us. So while we were singing last night to each other, Johnny kept... I got to take a picture of this next time. Motioning with both of his arms going back and forth. You, both, you. It's your birthday, you know. And then we're at the restaurant and he puts his hand up. So he thinks he's, you know, whispering. He's talking to the girl waiting on us, telling her he wants a cake. You know, what do you have for a birthday cake for these people? So she came out, and instead of just little candles, they have like sparklers that shoot up about 3 feet, these flames. I was wishing I had my hat on. I didn't want one of these little pieces of stuff to fall on my bald head. But anyway.
So. That sounds like quite a party. I like it.
Oh, it was. It was awesome. He's an incredible kid. Hmm. He's got more going than I give him credit for. I don't know how many times my wife and I said, man, he understands these things. I think we're going to get to heaven. He's going to say, yeah, I knew everything that was going on. But okay, here we go. So this is some of the things that I found this morning and I felt like God put on my heart today for our podcast. So let's pray. Father, thank you for how John enjoys his parents, and thank you for his way of honoring us and blessing us and celebrating us and our birthdays. What a big heart. Thank you for him. And thank you that we have an opportunity now to, as your children, celebrate you and bless you and draw near to you. Thank you for the studies that we've had and how many times you've met us and revealed things to us. And I pray today that as we draw near to you, that you'll draw near to us. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that cleanses us afresh every time we draw near to you. Thank you for your Spirit that's on hand to fill us and to teach us and to point us to Christ. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So we've finished our study on the tabernacle, I think. We've talked about how the lessons that David learned were not relegated to David and a few special people, but he was able to pass those lessons on to Asaph and the sons of Korah, which is extremely encouraging to me that we don't have to be Moses number two or David the third. We can just be who we are. We're like the sons of Korah. Some of us had godly fathers, some of us didn't. Doesn't make any difference. Whether we're Asaph, sons of Korah, we can seek God. So where are we now? Now that we've done this study, boy, would I like to have a Zoom call with everybody that listens to these talks and just say, what have you learned? What's God put on your heart? How have these studies impacted you? I don't know how to do that.
We probably could.
Well, I would love to. So if you're listening, Scott tells you at the end how to contact us. My email address is there. But let's have a Zoomcast sometime and just hear how these studies on the tabernacle have impacted you. Because ultimately, when I think of the tabernacle, I think of God seeking us and coming near to his people, not being content to be on top of the mountain, not being content to be in heaven, but providing a way for us to draw near to him and him to draw near to us. This is it. This is what I see when I see the tabernacle. And I see that the only way to come to the Father is through his Son. And as we've seen probably 30 times, his Son is in the tabernacle. Every aspect of the tabernacle, we have seen Jesus. So this morning, and it actually started last night when I was driving home from dinner. We took two different vehicles for some different reasons, and I was alone in the car. And so I turned on my Bluetooth on my phone, and I listened to Psalm 50. Now, I don't know if you've ever read Psalm 50, but this is a very important passage to me, because 2018, when I was learning how to seek God according to the principles of Psalm 100, I was talking to him about it one time after several months, and I said, am I on the right track? Am I supposed to pursue this and continue to do this? Is this of you? I sensed it was, and the passage that he brought to my heart was Psalm 50, verse 23. It's the last verse. The one who offers his sacrifice of thanksgiving glorifies me. To one who orders rightly his way, or orders his way aright. Different translations have different ways of putting it. I will show the salvation of God. And God was talking to my heart, and he said, yes, this is the way. I want you to pursue this, because if you will order your way correctly, if you will order your ways to seek me like this, I will show you the salvation of God. And you know what? I believe we've seen God's salvation in the tabernacle. By the way, the expression "show the salvation of God" in the Hebrew is Arinu Beisha Elohim, which in English and in the New Testament is, we will see Jesus. That's it. Because I believe that Jesus is the salvation of God. So let me go through and just take apart some of these as you call it, just do some deep dives into some of these words just to get us started. The one who offers his sacrifice, and the word for sacrifice does mean to slaughter, to kill. It is a real sacrifice. So we're offering our sacrifice of thanksgiving, which is toda, which means to thank or praise. So this is the way we come into his presence now, with thanksgiving. We enter into his courts with praise. So I'm putting together Psalm 100, Psalm 50, and in my head, I'm walking into the tabernacle. So I'm putting all of them together here. And when you do this, you glorify God. He says, the one who offers his sacrifice of thanksgiving or praise glorifies me. Well, that's number one. We want to glorify God. The next phrase says, to the one who orders rightly. And orders rightly is the Hebrew word sum, and it means to place a put or appoint. And when I think of that word, I think of the priests who had appointments with God. They set themselves twice a day, once in the morning, once in the evening, to offer the lamb, to fill up the oil in the holy place, to make sure there was incense burning. And this was an appointment. They had a regular rhythm. They were going to order their way rightly every day to seek God. And the word for way is derek, which means his ways, his conduct, the road he's on, his journey. And this is what I think that God was communicating to my heart was, I need to develop a rhythm of making up this appointment, these divine places to connect with God, to order my ways right, and to give sacrifices of thanksgiving and praise. And I've been doing this now for a couple of years now, and it's produced such good fruit. And I shouldn't just say fruit, because that's, I don't know how to describe it. That's more third person. I've connected with God. That's it. That is fruit. And then the last part of this says, I will show. And the word is arenu, but the root word is ra'ah. We talked about this word. It means to see. He's going to help us to see the salvation. And this is where it gets pretty cool. This root word is beyesha, from yesha, Y-E-S-H-A in English, which means it's the noun, the salvation. And the last word is Elohim, of God. If we will set ourselves to offer sacrifice of thanksgiving, if we will order our way, develop a rhythm, meet God on our journey, he will show us the salvation of God. And it's pretty clear to me that Yeshua is Jesus. He's the salvation of God. Now that word Yeshua, it's a noun, and it's connected to the verb to deliver, to save, which is Yasha. But Yesha is a noun. It's used 36 times. And I looked up several of these times. And in fact, every time I read through the list, all 36 of them, I was edified. I'm going to read you three from Psalm 18. Three times it appears in one psalm. Second verse, the horn of my salvation. 35th verse, the shield of your salvation. 46th verse, the God of my salvation. And I kept going back. I just kept feeling drawn. And this is the thing that's hard to describe, but these studies are not just me going, oh, I need to do A, B, and C, but I'm kind of listening. I'm leaning on God. I'm trusting that the Holy Spirit is going to teach me something about God. And so I listen for these prompts, and I felt to go back and read them again. And then I noticed that there's a big section in Psalm 85 using the word Yesha three times. And the fourth time, even though it doesn't use it, you're going to see it's exactly what we talked about just a few episodes ago. Restore us in the fourth verse, O God of our salvation, Yesha. Seventh verse, show us your loving kindness, O God. Well, no, it's O Jehovah, and grant us your salvation, Yesha. I will hear what the Lord Jehovah will say, for he will speak peace to his people, to his godly ones. Ninth verse. Surely his salvation, his yesha, is near to those who fear him. And the 10th verse, the perfect ending. Loving kindness and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. We've talked about that verse. That's when mercy was on top of the law. Mercy and truth, loving kindness and truth met. In John chapter 1, grace and truth have met together in Christ. So even though the word yesha isn't used in the 10th verse, clearly speaking of Jesus. So Psalm 85 uses that word yesha again. I was really edified to find Jesus in this word, my salvation. I will show you the salvation of God, which is Jesus. Then this word came to me, this expression. People who set themselves to seek God. And I just finished the Chronicles. I am in Ezra right now. I'm in the middle of Ezra. I'm going to read chapters 6 and 7 this morning, but haven't yet. But I just finished the Chronicles. And when you read 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, you see that there were men that were determined to follow God, and there were men who were determined to follow Baal. There was no in between. And the whole nation varied according to who was king. When the good king was on the throne, the nation was blessed. And you had some great kings. You had Hezekiah, and you had Uzziah, and you had some kings that were just amazing. You also had some sad ones, like Amaziah, who set himself at the beginning and then fell away at the end and ended up a miserable situation. But the expression, I think it was about Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles 19, another good king, it says, third verse, you have set. Now that word set is the Hebrew word that means to determine, to make firm. You have set your heart. And heart, the Hebrew word is labab, L-E-B-A-B. I think it might even pronounce labab, like with V sounds, but it's the heart. And I studied that word many, many years ago, not knowing as much Hebrew as I do now. I knew that the word had the L-E-V sound, like lave, labave, but I just looked up all the words in the Old Testament about heart, and David was a man after God's heart. And out of the abundance of the heart, it says in the New Testament, the mouth speaks, our treasure and our heart connected. So the heart is critical. So Jehoshaphat set his heart. He firmly determined, he purposed in his heart to seek, which is darash, to seek or inquire of God. And then two verses I thought of. You will seek the Lord your God, and you will find him if you search after him with all your heart and with all your soul. That's Deuteronomy 4:29. Deuteronomy 6:5 says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. And then one of my new favorite chapters in the Bible is 1 Chronicles 16. This is when David is instructing the Levites and the priests, now that the tabernacle is no longer a part of their culture, the temple is now the center, the ark has been moved from the tabernacle into the temple, and he says, now your job is to offer thanksgiving and praise. It's what we started with in Psalm 50, the one who offers his sacrifice of thanksgiving and praise. He said, this is what you're going to do. And in the 11th verse, he has this wonderful passage. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. I didn't look it up, but I'd be willing to bet big money that that word presence is seek his face continually. 2 Chronicles 7:14, you should know this verse. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Psalm 27:8, you have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. So this is the question on the table. Where are we? Are we inspired to set a rhythm? Are we determined to order our ways in a way that we can seek God and seek his presence continually and seek his face? It says in Psalm 105, which is reiterating 1 Chronicles 16, he says, seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. And now let's bring it back to the tabernacle. John 1:14 says, the word became flesh and tabernacled among us. Jesus is the tabernacle. He came and dwelt among us. He lived with us. He tabernacled with us. He pitched his tent, committed to us. And then my mind went to John 15:4. Abide in me, tabernacle in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. So before I close in prayer, what's going on in your mind and heart, Scott?
Two things. Isaiah 55:6.
Ooh, I like that verse. I love Isaiah 55. Go ahead.
Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. That feels really poignant to what you're just saying, what we're going through right now. Like,
yep.
It's such an urgent time. I mean, I don't know dates and times, but it sure feels like there's an urgency to what's going on in the world, and we need to seek him while he may be found.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, as I was out walking and praying this morning, I thought, you know, in the last days, it says, number one, a lot of believers are going to heap up teachers unto their own lusts. They're going to find sermons and preaching that they really like. Mm. You know, and it talks in Jeremiah about these false prophets who said, oh, yeah, everything will be fine. Peace, 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 right?
Yeah.
Right before Jerusalem was overthrown. But then it also says in the last days, people will be hungry for God's word. There's going to be this division. There are going to be those that are, they don't want to hear God's word. They don't want to hear the truth. They just want to hear things that make them feel good. And on the other hand, you're going to have those people, which I believe is our audience, that are hungry. They're thirsty. They want to know God's word. They want to know God himself. And that's exactly what Jesus says in John 15. He says, abide in my word, abide in my love, abide in me. In my presence. This is it. And I think God is holding it right out to us. My hands are open, by the way, right now. So let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for these scriptures that encourage us. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for Jesus, righteousness in the flesh, for they shall be satisfied. Thank you that we have a heart that we're still listening to you, we're seeking you. And I pray that you'll give us an appetite, a thirst to tabernacle with you who came to tabernacle with us. And I know that this is your will because it says in the word of God, this is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked from him. So, Father, here's our request. Satisfy our hunger and our thirst. Increase our hunger and our thirst. Give us an appetite to seek God and remove all the obstacles that are hindering us from ordering our way aright so that we can see Jesus. Pray that you'll remove the obstacles, that you'll give us fresh faith, fresh courage, fresh hope, and that you'll make a level plane for us to run into your arms, to see you and to believe in you in a whole new way. Bless us to that end, each of us, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.